Welcome everyone to the next the new year of the One World Combinatorics Onwards seminar. So thank you all for joining us. Our first speaker of the new academic year is Arseny Shur from the Ural Federal University of Yekaterinburg. And he will talk to us about the abelian repetition threshold.
Thank you, Narat. So let me start. In fact, repetition threshold is one of central topic in combinatorics on words, and one of the most visible results of this century in combinatorics of words was a proof of usual repetition threshold. And here I will speak about natural generalization of this notion to the abelian case. Okay. And as it's written, this is based on a joint work with Yelena Petrova, also from our university. Okay, let's recall the necessary stuff about repetitions. So in the very broad sense, a repetition is just a pair of equal factors. And the location of this factors can matter. The factors can be located in a disjoint way, like in onion, or consecutively, like in cocoa, or they can overlap, like in the word banana. So there are three different kinds of repetition in terms of mutual location of equal factors. And the simplest repetitions are integral powers of a word. So you can write UU to get a square, UUU to get a cube. You can write UD times to get U to the power of D, D or D power. And the main notion we work with in respect with integral powers is the avoidability. And any class of repetition is instead to be K avoidable if having a K alphabet of K letters, you can construct infinitely many words which contain no repetitions from this class. So in the same way, like banana contains a repetition NNA, which is a pair of overlapping factors. And another way to say the same is that there is an infinite word over this K array alphabet, which contains no repetitions from this class. For example, this all started from the work by Axel Tue, and in his first work on words, Tue proved that squares are three avoidable and cubes are two avoidable. And in some sense, this closed the problem about avoidability of integral powers. Closes basic questions, because it means that D powers are K avoidable, always except for the case when D equal to K equal to 2. So squares are not too avoidable. We don't consider the alphabet of one letter because it's nonsense with respect to repetitions. Okay, let's move from integral powers to integral abelian powers. There are a lot of notions of weak repetitions when the equality is replaced with some relation, with some binary relation, which is symmetric and length preserving. It need not be an equivalence, for example. can be non-transitive, for example, or can be even non-reflexive, but it's a rare case, but at least there are some examples. For example, you can consider approximate equality, say this Hamming distance up to some constant, or you can consider compatibility, where two words are compatible if all letters in the corresponding places satisfy the compatibility relation on the alphabet. Or you can consider complementarity, like Watson-Crick complementarity, when the relation is not reflexive. Or you can consider conjugacy when the two words are cyclic shifts of each other, so on and so on. And one of these natural generalizations, in some sense, the most algebraic one, is the abelian equivalence. And in what follows, I always will abbreviate right A dash something, like A equivalence. Two words are abelian equivalent if they are anagrams of each other, or in other terms, if they are equal as multi-sets of letters. A couple of examples in English is triangle and integral are, in fact, equal as sets of letters, not only multi-sets. And in the other examples, in Nikin, this is non-degenerate multi-sets. And when we speak about integral A powers, we just generalize the relation from the previous slide, the notion from the previous slide. So we say that A square is a word of sort U1, U2, where U1 and U2 are abelian equivalent. A cube consists of three such words, and dA power consists of d such words, and so on. And in the same way as in the previous slide, there are known classical results about availability of integral abelian powers. For example, first results are the results by Deking, first optimal results. I would say only about optimal results. He proved that A cubes are three avoidable and four abelian powers are two avoidable. And later, Kerenian proved the optimal results about abelian squares, that they are four avoidable. And this was a final answer to the question by Erdős, who asked for availability, for K availability for some K, and there were earlier results for bigger Ks, but the final result is that A squares are four avoidable. And so this is an abelian counterpart of the results by Tuer. Okay, let's do the next step. Let's move to the repetition threshold. Okay, we can generalize integral powers of words with fractional powers. If we have a rational number alpha greater than one, we say that a word V is an alpha power of some word U if the following conditions are satisfied. So the main condition is that V is a prefix of the infinite word constructed of U's, of U to the power of omega. V is its prefix, and the length of this prefix is alpha times the length of U. And in some quite common notion of exponent, which is just this alpha, in the case where the word U is primitive, so it's not an integral power of a shorter word. And it's worth noting that this notion, it extend the notion of the integral power. So if alpha is an integer, then it's exactly the previous notion of integral power. And we will say that what is alpha free if it contains no powers of exponent alpha or bigger, and alpha plus free if it contains no powers of strictly bigger exponent. And we say that an exponent alpha or alpha plus is k-avoidable if we can construct infinitely many such words of a k-ary alphabet. And then the notion of repetition threshold, which originated from the paper of 1972 by Francine Dijon, is the following notion. Repetition threshold of is a function of k, which equals on k to the minimum of to the infinitum of the set of k avoidable exponents alpha. And Dijon conjectured that repetition threshold over three letters is 7,4, RT of 4 is 7,5, RT of k is k over k minus 1 for all other cases. And this finally became a theorem due to efforts of a lot of people. So the case k equal to 2 is made by Tue well before this notion appeared. The case RT of 3 was done by Dijon, RT of 4 was done by Ponsieux, and so on and so on. Other was split. So the most of the cases were done by Arturo Carpi, who proved that conjecture holds for all big alphabets. And so what is some features to be noted about this repetition threshold? That the lower bounds prove that all of these lower bounds are very easy. So in fact, the only non-trivial lower bounds are in these two cases. And even this case, which is the longest to length over 100, there are in fact very small amount of words. So for your laptop, it would be a split of second to enumerate all of them, in spite of the length of about 100, a very small language of word, which avoid 7/5. So the lower bounds are very easy, but the constructions are quite hard. So only for two and three letters, you can rely on just on morphisms. And for bigger alphabets, was an earlier result by Brandenburg, so no morphism could prove this conjecture. And all other results are based on a binary encoding of threshold words. Okay, let's make the next step. Let's try to extend this notion of fractional power and the notion of repetition threshold to a abelian case. The ultimate goal is to prove a threshold theorem for abelian powers. But first problem is to define, to choose an appropriate definition of fractional abelian power. It's not that trivial, because what we require for the definition, first we require that it should be compatible with alpha powers. So an alpha power should be an alpha A power in our definition, because equality is a partial case of abelian equivalence. Second, we want to be compatible with integer abelian powers. So if we have integer alpha, our definition should lead exactly to dA powers defined on the previous slide. And another requirement is that if you have an alpha power of some length, you can add some letters on the left or right, at least from the one side to get the next integer power of symbol. And a bonus requirement, not necessarily, but quite nice, would be a symmetry under reversals. It's a very good property when you have that reversal of alpha a power is also an alpha a power. So for the case when alpha is at most 2, you have such a definition. The definition is that you define this power as a word of the form uv u prime, such that u and u prime are abelian equivalent, and this is a length, and this serves as a period for the case of power, and the ratio is alpha. So this is exactly how you can define this one of equivalent definitions for usual alpha powers. And for the case alpha greater than 2, there are several candidates, but all have drawbacks. We should choose some of them. So first candidate, you can take a d power and add some tail from the right, which is less in some sense that the sum of ui in some abelian sense. Or you can require that this tail on the left, or you can require that it may have two tails. But in these two cases, you will obviously lose symmetry. And the third case, which is symmetric, you lose compatibility with integer powers, because you have can have a length which is a multiple of the length of u, but you have two tails and no integer power. So given all of that, we choose one definition. We choose a definition which is compatible also with this one. And we decided then we'll take right tails and define left tails as dual powers. And we just say that this power is a word u1 to ud u prime, such as d is an integral part of alpha. All of these u's are abelian equivalent, and u prime is abelian equivalent to the prefix of u1, and the usual length requirement. And we can say that a dual power if we put this tail on the left, or in other words, dual power is a reversal of usual alpha power. And this extends the definition for alpha smaller than 2. And in fact, this allows us to speak about abelian repetition threshold. We can say that the word is alpha a3 gives the same definition as for usually alpha freeness and alpha plus freeness, replacing powers with abelian powers. So it contains no factors of bigger, how to say, abelian exponent. And the same notion of Ka availability. Okay, abelian availability. And then we can define what is abelian repetition threshold. You just take the definition of abelian threshold, you add A on the left and A on the right. And this notion has sense. For example, the earliest result, without mentioning this notion, was the result by Kasseni and Kari. They proved that any 1 plus epsilon, any rational 1 plus epsilon is Ka avoidable for some k. But they proved this only for very big k, which is a very loose bound. So it's exponential in the inverse of this epsilon. But at least it proves that any abelian exponent greater than 1 is Ka avoidable, so the limit is 1. But we want to know a bit better about this, what the values of abelian repetition threshold are. And so in the paper from 2010, and later journal version, we with Alexey Samsonov, we did the following. We did the definition of abelian repetition threshold and some variations for different definition of fractional powers. And for this definition, we get analytic lower bound, k minus 2 over k minus 3. For this is not ka avoidable for all k starting with 5. And for some rather easy search, we found that 9/5 is not 4a avoidable, 11/3 is not 2a avoidable. And for three-letter alphabet, we gave no easy lower bound better than the trivial bound 2. Squares are not, abelian squares are not 3a avoidable. It's a very simple. You can construct what up to length 7 or 8. And we also get some upper bound for the growth rate of avoiding languages, which are not quite precise. And the main the main thing from that paper is a conjecture how the repetition, abelian repetition threshold should look like given all that we know at that moment. And the conjecture was as follows. The conjecture was that threshold for 2 is 11/3, the threshold for 3 is 2, for 4 is 9/5, and for k it's this k minus 2 over k minus 3. Yeah, and what we have now that no case of this conjecture is proved. There is even no proof that the threshold must be actually between between this number and this number. So the threshold for repetition threshold for words is always the case that some number alpha is not avoidable, but alpha plus is avoidable. But nobody proved that the same works for abelian powers. For example, can it happen that abelian repetition threshold for 4 is in fact equal to 2? 2 is not reachable, so 2 is avoidable, but still 2 can be the infimum of all avoidable. It's at the moment we have no proof of the fact that it's not so. And in fact, all the constructions which were presented by Deking and Kerenin and all later modification of that construction, all of them cannot avoid anything smaller than the integer powers for which they were designed. So for example, the Kerenin's morphism and its modifications, they do not avoid 2 minus epsilon abelian powers for any epsilon greater than 0. So in other words, if you construct a word by using Kerenin construction, it will contain almost abelian squares. So like factors of the form UV U prime, where V is a single letter and U and U prime are abelian equivalent. So a bit long such word, so it doesn't avoid any power smaller than 2. And the same works for Deking's morphisms. So the known tools do not allow to lower the upper bound. And the question, of course, to start analyze this, is necessary to understand some reasons why the situation is so bad for abelian case. And mainly, I think that there are two main reasons for badness of this. Maybe I didn't mention the possible third reason, which was mentioned by Jeff in his talk, that all abelian stuff are not automatic in some sense, and you cannot prove abelian properties using automated provers. And so the two reasons I want to show here, the first is that equality, they're always obvious, but the consequences are not that obvious. Equality is inherited by prefixes and suffixes. So in fact, if you have two equal words, then the prefixes of the same length, suffixes of the same length, and as a consequence, the factors of the same length in the same position are equal. And nothing of this works for abelian equivalents. So in fact, you can have two abelian equivalent words with no abelian equivalent prefixes, no abelian equivalent suffixes, and even no abelian equivalent factors in the same positions. And this means then when you prove that some word is alpha free for usual powers, then you can show that in fact you can it's enough to check that there is no pair of equal factors among n square pairs. So if you take any suffix or any factor, you want to check whether it is in some other position, and you also can check just one position on the left, just one position on the right, and it's enough to check. So there will be only a quadratic number of pairs. And for abelian powers, you can prove that you, in general, when you check rational powers, you should check a cubic number of pairs. Because for any abelian, any factor, you should check for abelian equivalent factors in many places, in fact, in a linear number of places. Yeah. And the second reason why the abelian stuff is hard is that if you have two random words of length n, then the probability of equality is very small. It's inverse exponential. But the probability of abelian equivalence is much bigger. It's inverse polynomial. And what does this mean? It means that if your word is not alpha free, it almost surely contains a short alpha power. It's if you will take random words and check the alpha freeness, that a vast majority of them will have only which are not alpha free will contain a very short forbidden factor. And for abelian factors, it's not the case. You have a polynomial here, you have inverse polynomial here, and it may happen that that some reasonable share of all words which are not alpha abelian free will contain only long alpha abelian powers. And this means, in particular, that you should check for very long words. And this should make harder to construct some regular constructions like morphism and so on. So the main wrong word here should be to detect, of course, to detect alpha A freeness, you may need to study very long words. And this is a real problem because it's hard to study long words which are not regularly generated. Okay, how we will approach this? We want to approach this using some randomization and using prefix trees. We recall that language is factorial if it's just closed under taking factors of words. And of course, the languages of alpha free words and alpha A free words are factorial because it's inherited by factors. And any factorial languages, factorial language can be represented by its prefix tree. This is a tree with a root and labels on edges. The set of nodes coincide with L, so nodes are just words. And each edge has the form U to UA, where U to UA it's labeled by A. And in particular, this means the following. First, the path from the root to node U, it spells U. So U is written on this path. One node is an ancestor of another node if this word is a prefix. And the stuff looks like this. Here, this is the top part of the tree of square-free ternary words. Labels are colors. Yeah, so the alphabet is green, blue, red. And for example, this node represents the word red, green, red, red, blue, red, green. And this represents green, red, blue, green, and so on. And as you see, some nodes have two children, some had one, only root has three. And below there will be also, of course, words which have no children, and so on. So this is an example of how such tree looks like. And what we want to understand the language through the structure of its tree. And we know that the language is infinite if and only if it contains words or finite words of arbitrarily big length. And so our idea is to construct long words as random walks in this prefix tree. Random walk is in fact, it's a stochastic process is a Markov chain, which results in a walk or a word. And we construct it by a depth first search. So we start from the root. And when we visit a node, we try some new letter. When we first visit a node, all letters from our alphabet are new for you. We try a new letter, we choose it at random, uniformly, and go to the corresponding child if it exists. So we say that A, we try the letter A, it's no longer U for you. If this UA is in our language, we go to UA, visit it's the next node to visit. And if it's not in L, we repeat our choice with this letter excluded. And finally, if there's no letters which we are not tried, we are in some dead end and we return to the parent of U, all as you do in depth first search. And we keep track of the number of visited nodes and we keep track of the maximum depths we reached. So the maximum length of the word we construct. And we stop even if we reach the goal of the length of the walk, or if we reach the limit of the number of tries or the number of nodes visited. And then we just do some natural science. We do multiple experiments, we analyze statistics, we formulate conjectures. So this is just, we just try to do some science. Okay, I will present the result of what we obtained by this science. But first I should know that we have an algorithmic problem, first of all. Because in the previous slide, I know that we should decide this thing, whether the we add the letter and whether the word is still in L. And this is our key algorithmic problem for the search, and efficiency of our search depends on the efficiency of solving this problem. And okay, so a typical solution is a some data structure which stores necessary information about you, because we know that you is in L. We store the information about you. We update it fastly from you to UA and back from UA to you. And this structure is endowed with some algorithm which answers the query, about UA in L. So this is a view on the typical solution, and what we designed for a billion power three languages. So in fact, we tried several solutions, and for the to make the reading easier, I will color some of the results. First, we have a naive solution, which in very naive way, it will work in cubic time. If you add some gadgets, then it will work in quadratic time. And it just need no additional structure. So your update is constant time and you need a linear space. And there is a sort of greedy algorithm we used, and it is, has a still very fast update time. And then it's still worst case will be n square. But if you want to do multiple experiments, we are not interested in the worst case. We are interested in the average case. And in the average case, it works in n to the power 3/2. It's much faster, but still it's not quite fast. It's still quite slow. And we have also an algorithm which based on dictionaries. We just store all factors of U up to a billion equivalents. We store them in the dictionary. And this allows us to, after proving some lemma, this allows us to retrieve the result very fast. We just for each suffix, we in constant time check whether it constitutes a forbidden power with some other factor of the word. So this gives a linear time solution, but at the expense, since we are storing information about all factors, it's quadratic time space complexity. And this limits the lens very, very strongly, so up to like 10,000 in the usual laptop, or maybe 50,000 if you have a workstation. So not further. You cannot get millions. Okay, and for the case where alpha is greater than 2, it's a separate case, because first you can benefit from detecting integral abelian power. It can be done a bit faster. And still it appears that we are that slow, but it appears that if we, instead of this, if we detect dual abelian powers, which have a tail on the left and integral power on the right, and we add a letter from the right, then we can do it extremely fast. In square root time, so it's extremely fast, and in fact this means that for alphabets when we are interested in studying powers which are greater than 2, so for binary and ternary alphabet, we really can construct words up to say length of million, because it's very fast. But and we can study dual powers, because they are just we can study words, or instead we can study reversals of these words. This is the same in terms when we are interested in availability. Okay, and so it's a time to show something from this science, because a science presentation should contain graphs of some physical, say, quantity depending on the other quantity. And here, this is a graph of current depth of some random walk from the number of visit nodes. So vertical axis is a current depth, and the horizontal axis is a number of visited nodes. And in the upper part, we have a graph of a random walk in the in the language over five letters, avoiding 3/2+ the language which is supposed to be a Abelian threshold language in the conjecture from 2010. And we say that walks like this are look infinite like, because we have a steady growth of the depth of the current node from the length. And you can see that it's like 130,000 of nodes we visited, and we reached 60,000 in length of a world. So it's very, very quickly. And in the bottom, you have another graph. You take a quaternary language, which avoids 9/5+, which also was supposed to be a threshold language, an infinite language. And here, the picture is different. You can see that here you have 10 millions. Here you have 2,500. And the general picture is different. And moreover, we even used some cheating in to push the process further down the tree. So when we stayed very long for one place without increasing length, we made some forced backtrack. So we dropped some last letters to go out from the dead end where the algorithm possibly stayed in some very big but shallow finite subtree. And this allowed us to move. But in fact, this dawned our best attempt for this language, or the longest word we ever constructed. In this random search, it has a length just before 2,500. And this is an example of so finite-like looking word. So it looks like we have a very big space. There are a lot of words here, but we cannot. The tree is very big but shallow. So it looks that starting from some point, we could not go down the tree. Still, it's a science result. There's no mathematical proof of this. But the results of experiments allowed us to state some conjecture and to split words in some cases. And it appears that for some other language, we obtain much more definite results. For example, we took this supposedly threshold languages for 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 letters. And it appeared that it's very hard to go down more than 100 letters. It appeared that we tried million nodes, 100 runs. And so the average depth you reached is here, the average maximal depth. The median is here, it's almost the same. So the distribution is some good distribution. And you increase this twice and you get roughly the same. And at that point, we decided that maybe we will be able to enumerate all words. Still, there are a lot of words. It's not like in the case with quaternary 7/5 free words, which could be enumerated just maybe even by hand. So the theorem, we proved that all these languages are fine. And so this we disproved the conjecture for these cases, and so we showed that it should be replaced by some new conjecture. So okay, and actual maximum length is here, so it's quite close. Our random search reached 114, and the maximum length is 116, for example. Here, it's a bit worse here because a very big finite language. It's a bit worse here, and this star means that it's not its maximum length in some subset. We are not sure. It may be. Maybe 150 or 152, like that. This is because we used some optimized exhaustive search. We could not search everything. We just based on this lemma, I very briefly say about it. This lemma says how you can shrink the search space. First, you can use symmetry about permutations of the alphabet. You can always start with words which appear, say, 0, 1, 2, and so on. And thus avoid studying words which can be obtained as permutations by permutation of the alphabet. And the other thing is that this lemma allows to split our search space into several subspaces. So the main subspace, we consider all words which start with a permutation of all letters of the alphabet. K permutation. What is all letters the same? We start with this word. If this is finite, then we start from this shorter word and say that we want to search, and we stop the search if we find a permutation, because we know that from permutation it's finite tree. And here we do the same with this almost permutation. And this one appears every two letters. You should say you should find k minus two distinct letters. And so we made all these searches. This one is short, these two are long. And in fact, the total number of words to study ranges from less than 500 million for eight letter alphabet. This is the smallest one, but for 10, it's already over 500 billions. So this growth is more than 1,000 times. It's clear that for 11, you could not do this the same. And so from 6 to 9, we were able to do this search, longer search, and find the maximum length of a word. So this figures in the table were absolute. And this here, we just know the maximum length in these three languages, three subsets, and don't know what if we start here, then get sub permutations, and maybe get permutation. Maybe we'll do a bit farther looking at the other elements. And since that I'm about to finish with my talk. So the main, what we want to present is some conjecture. But to make a conjecture to replace the conjecture from 2010, we need to get some more experimental results. And in fact, we tried many words and alphabets. First, we understood that we can, for k equal to 7 or more, we get the same behavior if we take a bigger language. Not k minus 2 over k minus 3 plus, but k minus 3 over k minus 4. And here we are absolutely sure that it's also finite, but it's not searchable, not exhaustively searchable. And we also find a finite-like behavior for this language. Even we were able to construct with some combination of search such a long word, and also for this language, even a longer word, and for this language. We are sure that all these languages should be fine. And also our results suggest that these languages are infinite. And we are also among language we tried, this one is uncertain. We couldn't say more what is needed. And so our main result of this talk is this conjecture. So in fact, this threshold is greater and we have no bound between 11-3 and 4, no better upper bound. Here we have an upper bound of 5/2 suggested. Here we have no bound between this and 2. Here is the only case which remains from the old conjecture. And I suppose the next step, and I invite all of you to do this next step and to prove this fact. And here we have 4/6, and we will be able, I think, to improve it to find better upper bound, maybe here. And this is for all bigger languages. So the details of this talk can be found in this preprint recently published. And a future work, it's a lot of work in all directions. Starting from more experience, more experiments, and to get more experience, and finishing by improving upper bounds, and maybe ultimately to prove at least one case of this conjecture, maybe this case. And so I invite all participants to join this work. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Arseny. Does anyone have any questions?
I do have a question.
Yes, please.
It's Francesco Dolce.
Yes, please.
If I understand, so sorry, a moment. Can you turn down? Thank you. If I understand, can you go back to, could you go back to slide number 5, the basic definition of alpha mm-hmm. repetition?
Here. Okay.
Yes. So if I understand your definition of alpha A power, mm-hmm. is it possible that you have alpha A power such that a prefix is not beta A power? Or I try to reformulate in different terms. You can have yes. something that is not yes. an alpha A power, but you prolong it with some letters and you obtain a abelian power.
Yes, yes. This is the main problem. So this tail U prime, mm-hmm. it by definition it should be A equivalent to some prefix of U1, but it yes. may happen that no prefix of U prime is abelian equivalent to a prefix of U1, because if you require that any prefix of this should be a prefix of this, you will get a usual power, not abelian one.
Exactly, yes. So yes. I understand well. So why not to take as a definition that this prefix should have a paric vector that is less than the paric vector of U1?
It's a good question. It's exactly what and one of other variants which were considered in the in our paper with Samsonov I cited. That version you proposed was called weak abelian power, and this one was called strong abelian power. And the why we choose this one, because here it extends the definition for small abelian powers, and for small abelian powers this version is symmetric and weak version is not. Okay. So that's why we pay more attention to this definition. But that paper also contains some lower bounds for weak definition also. You can check. So there are some results about weak abelian powers also, but I think that about strong, it may be more interesting for, because most of the cases you deal with exponents which are smaller than two when you speak about repetition threshold. So you just should define for two more alphabets this thing. And that's why I consider this definition.
Thanks. Does anyone else have any questions? All right, if not,